But you're able to resolve them.
We're broadcasting.
Others support that.
Everything you're saying is official.
I'm just gonna check the audio.
You're gonna put this up?
I trust YouTube, but I don't trust YouTube, so I'm just verifying that.
YouTube.
It's actually working.
YouTube?
Isn't it?
Interesting. Well, if you didn't hear, we have some stickers if you want. We got some nano server stickers and some cool PowerShell boy stickers. They're awesome. Feel free to take a few from the coworkers, sell them on eBay.
All right, well, we can go ahead and get started. Thanks, everybody, for coming, and thanks, Janelle, for the new digs.
You're welcome.
A lot different. Nice.
Beautiful view.
Thanks, Jeffrey, for coming. This is the first official PowerShell user group meeting we've had here. Going forward, my name's Pizza and Minnesota over there. We're still working on, doing user group meetings in Ed's location. And in fact, I believe in June, we're probably going to have Trevor Sullivan doing a Google Hangout remotely. And he'll probably be talking Azure, so that should be a good one. And then we're lining up a couple other folks here. So we're probably not going to be able to do it monthly just because I'm 100 miles away. And to be honest with you, my wife kind of sick of me driving across the state so frequently. So now between us here, Ed in the South Bay, and then the occasional ones we do up in Folsom, we should have a pretty good cadence. Again, every meeting we have, we always try to stream it on YouTube. So if you can't make it, don't worry about it. Just reference the YouTube page. And that's at YouTube/user/NorCalPosh. That's really all I had to say. If anybody's at Build this week, lots of good news. And that's why I begged Jeffrey to come. No, he was very gracious with his time. But he had some big news this week, so luckily he gave his presentation today, so we can all hear it. Don't have to sign an NDA before we hear it. So,
anybody at Build this week?
No. Great. Well, I'll let you go. Thanks, Jeff.
All right. So I'm actually combining two talks here. So first is the version future of Windows Server, and then the second is sort of where we are with PowerShell and where we're going. I'm really excited about this Windows Server, this new version called Nano Server. By far, this is the most significant change we've made to Windows Server since Windows NT. That impactful. So that's pretty bold. So let's see about it. So basically, we start from the customer. What are we hearing from the customer? Now, what we hear is concerns around reboots, right? Reboots really impact my business. Every time I have to do reboot the server, I want it back very quickly. And it's one thing to say, well, I have to reboot the server because I patched a component that I'm using. Like, you can get your head around that. But it just seems unfair that you have to reboot your server because you patched a component that you're not using. Like, that just makes people's heads explode. Why am I doing that? Next is that the server images are very, very large, right? They take a long time to install. These big images moving across the network consume a ton of bandwidth and require a lot of resources. And then lastly, the infrastructure requires too many resources. So especially as we talk to hosters, they say, hey, if your OS consumed fewer resources, I could get more out of my hardware investment. Right, so have more resources available to my VMs or applications, and I can maybe can have higher VM density. So I really like that. Next, of course, as you know, last year was just a complete boof-a-rama for security. Right, I don't know about you, but I think a lot of people, certainly I was one of these people who heard the security people, and they're the sky is falling, and I'm just like, yeah. You know, you got this like hypothetical bad guy out there and, you know, these hypothetical threats. And really, it's just a scam to try and get more of the budget. Well, they were right. You know, the one thing that Edward Snowden made clear, like him, hate him, the thing that he made clear is all those security things, all those warnings were correct. And you might sit there and say, well, look, I like the NSA. I like the fact they're looking at things. I like the fact that they're taking advantage of these vulnerabilities to keep me safe. And here's the answer. They're using vulnerabilities that exist. And it's just a matter of time before the really bad guys use exactly the same vulnerabilities, okay? So we have to have a completely different approach and, you know, up our game, treat this stuff seriously, and up our game when it comes to security. Anyway, a lot of people have been taking this approach of the gold image, where you go and you put everything, you install everything on it, and you put that on every server and say, yeah, just ignore the stuff you don't use. That approach is disaster when it comes to security. And the entire, all that stuff represents a security footprint that can be attacked, a vulnerability that can be attacked. So you don't want to do that. If you're doing that, you really want to stop doing that. So ultimately what we hear from customers is they want a world that they want the components they need and then nothing else. Okay. So now let's talk about our server journey. Start off in Windows NT and Windows Server 2003, we really made no distinction between what a server was and what a client was. You know, the joke is a server was you take a desktop and you tip it over and you call it a server. In fact, Mark Rusinovich became famous by being the guy who pointed out, hey, the only difference between a server and a client is this registry key. Put this value in and you get the server. And so then quickly Microsoft released this patch, and then he found it again and said, hey, here's the new location, here's the new value. And he was just telling me this morning, he said, yeah, at some point Mark Wachowski, you know, wrote him an email and he said, okay, I give up. So the point was that, okay, so there really wasn't, we did not draw a distinction between what a client was and what a server was. And back then, that was actually okay, because it was about, here's a server, and here's my server, and I'm going to walk up to my server, and I'm going to manage it. There it is. I got it. And the fact that I could walk up to that thing, and I got a GUI with that next button, oh, man, wonderful, just wonderful. However, GUIs are poison. Admin GUIs on server are poison. And to be more specific, they're like heroin. Boy, that first shot of heroin felt so good, right? Then just ruins your life and ends up killing you. Now, that's literally what admin GUIs are on servers. I'm not joking, seriously. Now, why is that? And the answer is, when it's all about that precious little server, they're fine. It really doesn't matter. But as soon as you say, well, it's not about my precious little server, I got a bunch of these things, I got a data center, and especially when you say I'm going to the cloud, this idea of going to an individual server doesn't work. And it is as sure as a law of physics that when a developer writes a local admin GUI, what they do is they put the business logic in the GUI and they call private APIs. Now, it shouldn't be. I know teams, architects who understand these principles and told me, I was absolutely hardcore. We're developing this product. There will be no business logic in this. We'll use well-defined APIs, et cetera, et cetera. And we had goals and commitments from everyone. And we had code reviews. And then we got into the crunch with, oh, business logic in the GUI. We don't have to call APIs. And I'm really sorry, but that's the way it just works out. It's as though it's a law of physics. It always happens. So these local GUIs really mean that you don't end up with formal management APIs, which means you can't do remote management. And you can't do automation. And that's why they are poison. Because when you have lots of servers, you need remote management and you need automation so that you can perform a task, see if it did what you wanted it to do. If it didn't, change it. Did it do what you wanted it to do? No, change it. Did it do what you want to do? Yes, leave it alone. Now, do it to all the servers in a consistent way. I defy any of you to provision a server 500 mouse clicks with a mouse, right? 500 mouse clicks, get it exactly right. Now do that, implement those 500 mouse clicks on the next 100 servers exactly the same order. And it can happen, okay? So the point is that these local admin GUIs feel good the first time you use them, but in the end, they end up killing you. So we understood that. So starting in Windows Server 2008, we started to be clearer about what a server was versus what a client was. Okay, now here we weren't very clear with people, right? we started this thing called ServiceCore. It didn't have a GUI on it. And we made a number of mistakes in this time frame. So one was we were unclear about what scenarios we were going after, so it was a little bit difficult. We didn't have good Visual Studio support, and we didn't have very good management. However, the worst mistake of all was calling this thing full server. That sounded like a good thing. Oh, my server application, of course, is so hefty, it requires full server. They only require server core. No, no, no. This thing is the GUI stack. So anyway, that was a mistake. So, and by the way, so back in this stage, you picked one or the other, and if you got it wrong, just clean slate the machine, start over. We really fixed the situation in in Windows Server 2012 and 2012 R2. Now everything builds on Server Core. You can start at Server Core, you can go up all the way up to Server with a GUI, go back down. That's important because some tools, especially third-party tools, require the GUI for installation, but then run fine without it. Okay, we have full remote management for most things on Server Core. We have good manageability. This is a very good story. And when you install it, you get to install Server Core, which is the default and the recommended installation, or you can install something called Server with a GUI. Okay, so this is kind of the progression we've made. Now let's talk about the cloud. Okay, so as we go to the cloud, think about Azure. Azure has, I don't think we can tell how many, but many, many, many hundreds of thousands of servers, maybe more. And if you patch a host, Azure does not have live migration. So if you patch one of those hosts and you have to do a reboot, every single VM has to be rebooted. That's pretty big business impact. Okay. Next, I mentioned we have a lot of servers. A lot of servers times large OS resource consumption means that costs us a lot of money. Okay? And these very large images that get moved around the network, they consume a ton of network bandwidth, bandwidth that we would prefer to be servicing our customers with. Okay? Now, in the Windows Server space, of course, we have Cloud Platform Solution. Cloud Platform Solution is our cloud in a box. Go up to a website, say, I want a cloud in a box, say 1 to 4, and you get a cloud in a box, right? 1 to 4 racks. Now here, it has live migration. It has live migration. So if you have to patch the host, you can patch it without service interruption. So that's great. But now let's do the math. So in a 4-rack system, you can have 8,000 VMs. Actually, that's kind of a conservative number, but let's just go with 8,000. You have 8,000 VMs. Assume you've got 2 gigabytes per VM. That means every time you patch the host, I've got to move, live migrate 16 terabytes of data through the network, the same network I'm servicing my customers. So whereas you don't have a service interruption, you certainly have a service impact. Okay? So as you move to the cloud, size, reliability, and security, I haven't even talked about that, but clearly security is critical in the space. These become very, very important. So basically, as we looked at this, we concluded we needed a server configuration optimized for the cloud. Now here, I mean this literally. We needed a server configuration optimized for the cloud. I'm very sure that you need it as well, but I know we need it, okay? So that is what NanoServer is. NanoServer is our next step in this cloud journey. It is a dramatic refactoring of the Windows Server. It's headless, it's 64-bit only, and it's a deployment option for a server. So it is not a separate SKU. You got your SKU, standard, data set, whatever, and it's a deployment option. Oh, I want data center. Oh, do you want server with a GUI? Do you want server, or do you want NanoServer? So it's a deployment option of existing SKUs. It's a very deep refactoring, but here we are very clear about the scenarios that we're going after for version 1. Version 1, we're focused in on 2 scenarios, cloud OS infrastructure, and when we say that, we mean clustered hypervisor, cluster storage. So think back to CPS, the cloud platform solution. We run CPS as sets of clustered hypervisors and clustered storage servers. So that's what we're targeted for, cloud OS infrastructure. The next is born in the cloud applications. What is born in the cloud applications? That means stuff you probably don't have right now. Okay, things built for a cloud design center, right? So you're not going to be able to go take SAP as is or Oracle as is and run it on Nano Server. That's really not the model. The model is new cloud applications. And we're going to follow the server core pattern. By that, what we mean is it starts off as a separate installation option. We've got a well-defined, here we have a now a well-defined set of things that we're going after. And then you pick that or you pick that, and you better get it right, because if you get it wrong, you clean slate. So the roles and features, here what we're doing is we have what's called a zero footprint model. Have you ever noticed when you get Windows Server and you say, oh, I'd like to have RDS installed? You notice it never asks you for the media? Why does it ask you for the media? And the answer is, when we do the installation, we take all the software that's available and we put it on the disk. And then when you say, I want to install something, we move it from some cache into the local system. Okay? That's one of the reasons why the images are so large. That does not work in Nano Server. We got rid of that. In Nano Server, you install roles and features like you would an application. You bring it, and you bring the bits, and you put them on the bits. Okay? So there's no binaries or metadata in the system. The roles and features that we're going to have are, again, for version 1, Hyper-V and clustered, well, clustered Hyper-Vs and clustered storage. For born in the cloud applications, we've got the core CLR, as we now call that .NET Core, ASP.NET V5, and PaaS roles. It has full driver support. So if you have a Windows Server driver, it's going to work just fine here. However, you have to make sure that the installation does require the GUI. Crazy as it sounds, some people still write drivers that require GUIs. Got one of those, go call up your vendor and say, hey, McFly, it's 2015, you know, get out of the 1990s, and then you want silent installs. Also, we have the anti-malware agent. So I mentioned your security, we need to up our game in security. You'll see, we're going to talk a lot about this at Build next week. We have a substantial increase in our security investments. One of those is that the anti-malware agent is now installed by default in all servers. There's a bunch of additional stuff that we're going to talk about Build. I'll just give you kind of a big hint. Big hint is that we have a more mature approach to security. Okay? So in the past, we were almost exclusively focused in on protect, protect, protect. Harden the platform, protect the platform. You will see we will continue to invest in that. In fact, we have increased our investments in that. Things like including the anti-malware agent in the server. There's a number of other really crazy kind of science fiction stuff going to be announced at Build in that space. But we're also taking a more mature approach. And by that, it is an assume breach approach. Assume that the bad guys are in. Now what? How do I detect them? How do I find out where they are? How do I isolate them? How do I limit the damage? How do I get rid of them? Okay. Now, just to be clear, this is not a Windows 10 solved the problem. Boy, I'll tell you, Windows 10 dramatically makes things better. This really, however, is the beginning of the next 10-year journey of our trusted, worthy computing journey.
So at Ignite, your session that you and Mark are going to do will cover all the sessions that
Yeah, so at Ignite, Mark and I, Mark Sinovich and I, and Jeremy Winters, we're going to provide the sort of the foundation. So the keynote, we have a very small amount of time. We are going to go and talk about the areas that will be covered and really give a conceptual background for what it is you're going to go see. And then we'll have lots of details. So there'll be 7 kind of foundation sessions underneath us, a bunch around security, one on security, one around Linux, you know, compute, network, storage, service, and now I'm missing one.
Okay. So you'll have all the breakdown numbers.
Yes, we will. Yeah. And we're working with System Center and Apps Insight to get their agents on this environment. We are very early days with Nano Server. So the bits will be out next week or the week after that. I'm not entirely sure. If I did know, I'd get in trouble if I told you, I think. But we're very early days there. It will not have these agents there. They'll come shortly.
Real quick, Jeffrey, is it going to be easier to win RM to these nodes on non-domain joined?
Watch that face. We're going to talk about the management. So management. Okay, so the first here is that this is not the precious little server mindset, right? The DevOps guys, if you're not familiar with them, they have this wonderful phrase called treat your servers like cattle, not like pets, okay? So often we have, you know, we treat our servers like pets, or sometimes they call them snowflake servers. Each one's unique, right? So we give a pet a name when we give it a lot of care and loving, and when it's sick, we take it to the vet, okay? Cattle, we don't give names, we give numbers. When they get sick, we fire up the barbecue, right? You just don't care about an individual, you care about the collective, and that's the point. You just replace things. That's the model. So you want to have a model where you say, yep, I'm doing mass management, and the management doesn't really change whether I'm doing management of 10, 15, or 100. I've got a process, and I follow that process, as opposed to, oh, I do this to one, oh, now I have to do it to 100? That would be really hard. With DevOps, it isn't, because you figure out a process, and you do it once, and that's harder than originally just walking up, click, click, next, next, next. So you figure it out, but then you apply it, and you apply it to 10, 100, 1,000, whatever. So that's the model. So the goal here is to never stand in front of one of these servers and craft it by hand. So we do have remote automation and power and management by a core PowerShell in WMI. So that's core PowerShell. We'll hear more about that in a second. At this point now, in the past, PowerShell was based upon .NET. .NET was that's the full .NET. It's really quite large. And because it was quite large, we decided to make it an optional component. What that meant was that PowerShell was also had to be an optional component. Now, on NanoServer, we have the core CLR. Core PowerShell is a version of PowerShell written to the core CLR. It's really quite small, and both of those are now mandatory. So you will not be able to lose, you know, get rid of PowerShell on NanoServer. And of course, we have web access and a number of GUI tools to be able to manage this environment. Now, to get to your point, in this environment, remote management is absolutely critical. That's what you do everything. You do everything that way. And so you'll see step by step by step, we're increasing we're improving our remote management. And you'll see I've got a couple of examples that come up. Okay, so core PowerShell, by the way, it's a placeholder name. We'll call it something else. It won't be core PowerShell. It probably won't be. Anyway, so it's refactored and run on core CLR. It's got full language compatibility, has most of the engine components, but not all. The most significant one is workflow. So it doesn't have workflow. It's not as big of a problem as it sounds because workflow running, your PowerShell workflow running on another machine can manage PowerShell on Nano using PowerShell remoting. So that will work just fine. You do have full PowerShell remoting, and we have support for all the commandlet types, C#, PowerShell and Sim. However, if you have commandlets written in C#, those commandlets have to work on the core CLR. If they require the full desktop .NET is not there, therefore they won't work. So they have to work on the core CLR. Now, if you have commandlets that work with the core CLR, they're going to work just fine in the full CLR. So, and we start off, this was actually a very significant piece of work, very significant. It took us a very long time to get like Hello World running, okay? And then I think, you know, a few weeks after that, we had like 100 and some odd commandlets, 158 commandlets running. But then a few weeks after that, we had 300, and I think I just checked and I think we had over 600. So that's making very rapid progress.
So here, let me show you core PowerShell.
This is a quick demo of how to manage NanoServer using PowerShell. First, we'll start off by pinging the machine name Tuva PC in this case. Tuva was one of the early marketing names for Nano Server. And we're just going to go ahead and copy the IP address. It's going to come in handy in a second. Before we can start remoting PowerShell into Nano Server, we need to set the trusted hosts to that IP address that we just copied. And we confirm the prompt. And now we're ready to use Entropy Accession to remote into the Nano Server machine. You'll notice that I just specified the computer name here, and I did not specify any explicit credentials. What Entropy Accession does is pick up my implicit credentials, my network credentials on this machine, on this host machine. And of course, I've made myself an admin on the Nano Server machine as well. A quick ipconfig/all just to verify that we have the right IP address on the right machine. And in fact, we do. So first off, let's just do a get command and figure out what kind of built-in PowerShell commands are already available in Nano Server. You'll notice that command completion worked just fine with IntelliSense, parameter completion worked just fine with IntelliSense, and so did argument completion in IntelliSense as well. Quite a bit of commandlets, built-in commandlets are available. This is core PowerShell. So Nano Server has core PowerShell, not the full-fledged PowerShell that you're used to in client and server. If we do a quick measure object, we'll notice that we have like 150 built-in PowerShell commandlets core in core PowerShell on Nano Server.
Now about 600.
Language constructs. Let's do a quick for each simple loop that just prints out a three-digit D3, a three-digit number from 1 to 10 with fancy formatting, and that works just fine. Again, you should expect language constructs that work in PowerShell to work on core PowerShell in Nano Server as well. Let's see if redirection works. So for that, we're just going to get all the commands that have dash process at the end. We're going to select the first two and redirect to a text file under ctemp. Just to verify, let's just get the content of that file that we just created. And sure enough, redirection works just fine. So now let's see what kind of modules we have on Nano Server. I didn't copy any extra modules. These are just the built-in modules. NetTCP IP sounds interesting, so let's just copy that. Import the module. And I like to use dash verbose when importing modules because it just gives me the list of all the commands that are imported as I'm importing them. Saves an extra step of get command dash module. So let's use get now IP address. Specify the family IPv4 and do some fancy formatting with format table. Well, let's just spell it out. And choose a few fields. You'll notice that tab completion works just fine here as well, which is very handy. We'll choose interface index, address family, IP address, interface alias. And we'll just do an auto size, so it auto sizes the columns, and I don't have to do that manually. And sure enough, as expected, that works just fine. There are many other modules that you can just download and use on Nano Server. This is just an example of some of the built-in ones. Get PS provider also works as expected. All the PowerShell providers, whether it's registry, alias, environment, or file system, they all work as expected. Get PS drive shows you all the PowerShell drives on the system. Again, as expected, commands like dir, HK local machine, software, Microsoft will produce the expected results as well. Again, the idea is it's not all of PowerShell, but all the essentials of PowerShell are available in core PowerShell on Nano Server. And at the end, we're just going to exit PS session. And this was a quick demo of how to manage Nano Server from core PowerShell. Thank you.
I think Ed's going to swat you in the nose every time someone says people.
He's a tough audience. Okay.
Now, it makes sense why you were so excited about remotely updating files through ISC.
Yeah. Right. So you caught that. So basically now with we have improved the remote manageability. And honestly, this is one of those things. I like to say, Churchill once said, to govern is to choose. And Microsoft, we have a phrase for it, just to say, to ship is to choose, right? There's all the things you want to do, but if you want to ship, you got to choose and nail those things, because if you try and do too many things, you won't be able to ship anything. So whenever we do that, we say, oh, here are all these things that we want to do. We want to really improve remote manageability. But honestly, whenever we said, yeah, but there's this other thing I also want to do, and there's this other way to do that. So why don't we just, we'll get to it, but just not now. Well, with NanoServer, there is no other way to do things. You have to do things remoting, and so we're improving remoting. So we have things like remote file transfer over PSRP, that's the PowerShell remoting. You can say copy from, you know, copy item minus from session or minus to session. You have remote debugging, and you have remote file editing. So these are all just fantastic features. By the way, it also brings up another point. As I talk to customers, I talk about this focus in on the cloud. And a number of enterprise customers have said, well, okay, but what about me? Because I don't care about that cloud stuff. I'm in the enterprise, and I'm happy where I am. Well, not interested in doing the cloud stuff. And the answer is this. The vast majority, not 100%, but the vast majority of the things that we're going to do to improve things for the cloud are going to benefit the people who are not going to the cloud, who want to stay in the enterprise. These are great examples of that. But I liken it to the days when, if you recall, at some point, Microsoft was a desktop operating system. And at some point we said, well, we're going to become a server operating system. And people thought we were crazy. They laughed at us. I know, I was in the industry, I was laughing. And because at the time, the defining user experience of the desktop operating system was something called the blue screen of death, okay? And so you're like, what? Like, every couple of days, I'm getting this blue screen of death, and you're telling me you're going to take that and make it a server operating system? Like, you're out of your mind. And yet today, this year, 70% of the servers that get built this year will end up with Windows Server on them, okay? So it is the world's most successful enterprise operating system ever, okay? Now, the point is, when was the last time you saw a blue screen of death on your PC? They still happen, but they are really rare, really rare. And why is that? And the answer is, the work that we did for the server has to be robust, has to be reliable, has to be sturdy, benefited the desktop. In exactly the same way, as we shift our attention to the cloud, the vast majority of the things that we do for the cloud will benefit the enterprise as well. So don't get worried when you hear us talking about cloud, 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 if that's not your destiny. Most of the things are going to benefit you. Here's another great example. Okay, so people say, well, that's great, but there are some tools that don't have good remoting equivalents. And so guess what? Task Manager doesn't work well remotely. Registry Editor just doesn't work well remotely. It's a version, but Event Viewer, same thing. There's no Device Manager that works remotely. Sconfig. These are a set of tools that don't work remotely. So what we are doing is we're investing in web GUI interfaces for these that will work remotely. And they're going to work against NanoServer or Server Core or whatever version of server you want. Okay? Again, focusing on the cloud forces us to do a set of things that's going to improve everyone. I can't show you this.
Aww.
Maybe I'll show you. We're recording. Can we stop the recording for
pause it.
3 minutes?
Actually, what? Yes, you can.
There's a picture of a kid.
They won't even know.
Actually,
yeah. This is sort of embargoed until Jeffrey next week. Jude, are you saying that the additional tools will be made through the PowerShell Web Access? Is that?
No.
Okay.
Sounds like what the webman for running. Webman. You ever seen that? It's like that. It's like a GUI web interface for a lot of like.
Trying to get back to the Hangout. You can just mute yourself there.
Just make sure everything's good there. Should be back.
Sure.
And so, as I mentioned,
this is going to work against regular server core as well. So again, the things we're doing for the cloud benefit enterprise as well. Okay, so now we talked about, you know, the two scenarios. First is CloudOS infrastructure. The next is CloudOS born in the cloud applications. So here it's core, .NET Core, ASP.NET V5, and a subset of Win32. Now here I'll be really clear. Nano Server is server. It's Windows Server. Okay. So the APIs are the same for the components that are available. Okay. So if you write an application for Nano Server, it's going to run perfectly fine on server. Okay? If you write something on server, it may or may not run on Nano Server depending upon which APIs you call. Okay, so it's as simple as that. So this is now then going to be available everywhere. Okay, so it's available as a host OS on physical hardware. So Nano Server, you'll be able to run physical hardware. You'll be able to run it as a VM or in containers. We have two types of containers. Something called Windows Server containers. These are the equivalent of Linux Docker containers, or this new type of containers called Hyper-V containers. Hyper-V containers provide a substantial increase in isolation and therefore security. Okay, so think of it this way. With Windows Server containers, multiple containers on the same environment share a kernel. With Hyper-V containers, each of the containers has their own kernel. That's the key distinction. So it's more secure.
Windows Server containers sharing libraries? So they are sharing libraries from the core OS.
Yes.
And then Hyper-V, they are not.
Correct.
Okay. A question about the size, the footprint of the Nano Server. I mean, I know there's quite a reduction there, but how small is...
We're going to get there. Let's know how small. Patience, my friend, patience. Okay, so then additional features, you will manage this through desired state configuration. That's the way you'll manage things. That is not there in this next release. It'll be after that, and by the release, I mean the next preview will be available after that. And we used to have something called OneGet. That's now called the PowerShell Package Manager. That will be available later in the summer as well. But we're also now working on a set of language runtimes. So basically think of it this way. What do people write cloud applications in? And the answer is, whatever the answer to that question is, those are the things we're going to get running on Nano Server. So specifically, we've got Python, PHP, Ruby, Node.js, Java. What am I missing? Erlang? I haven't done Erlang yet. Anybody break anybody's heart? No, we're not doing it. Scala? Anybody care about Scala? No, I'm not doing Scala yet either. But anybody care about it? Put it on the list. Anyway, so we're getting all the language runtimes that matter on that environment. We have full Visual Studio support. So with the next Windows Server SDK, you'll be able to bring Visual Studio, you'll be able to start a project, you'll say, I'd like to write a Nano Server project. 64-bit, of course. As you start using the APIs, if you use an API that's not available in Nano Server, you will see squiggle brackets. When you do IntelliSense, it will show you the APIs that are available on Nano Server and will not show you the APIs that are not available on Nano Server. So that's what you want, okay? We have full debugging experience, remote debugging. So you write your stuff, you deploy your application, be able to set breakpoints, all that stuff works with Nano Server. Okay, so now here's the way you should think about this, because people get confused, right? They say, oh, well, do I code to containers or do I code to Nano Server? And you know, server versus, how does that work? So here's how it works. It's actually a very simple story. So what we're doing with the server is a deep refactoring of the server. We've got Nano Server. Nano Server is focused in on cloud-optimized applications. You have Server. It's focused in on compatibility. On top of that, you have a component that we used to call full server. Now we call it server with a GUI. In reality, it's the client stack, right? The shell, i.e. the client stack, right? So if you were a developer and you wanted to write a fart app, these would be the APIs you use, okay? We don't want those on servers, okay? So we've in the past have not been clear. We use some bad names. So these are clients. Now then you say, well, why would I ever want to have a client on a server? The answer is, oh, lots of reasons, right? In particular, remote desktop. Remote desktop is clients on a server, right? Multiple clients sharing a server. So it makes sense to have a client on a server. And then also look at tools. Think of small business server. Small business server really is, I'm a small business, I really do have, that is my server right there. I really do want to walk up to my server and manage it. So that makes sense, but don't be confused. It's a client stack. Server applications, don't code for the client stack. Again, no fart apps on my server, okay? So developers are going to target either server or nano server. You go, bring a Visual Studio, you pick which one, you then develop your XE. Now what do you do with it? And the answer is you then deploy it on either a physical, a virtual, or in a container. So something to nano server can run on a physical, it can run on a virtual, or it can run on a container. So it's that simple. So you don't code to containers, you don't code to a physical machine, you don't code to a VM. You code to a set of APIs and a set of components. There are two, server and nano server, and then you run it in something, physical, virtual, or containers. There we go. Now, word of caution. These are preliminary results. We have not done any performance work as of yet. So a number of these numbers, we expect to get better. We are also not done refactoring. So some of these numbers might get worse. Additionally, as we're doing this, we're looking and saying, I'm going to show you comparisons against Windows Server or Server Core. As we do some of this work, we might go and apply some of those changes to Server Core. So the differences between the two might change, but they'll be, you know, anyway, we'll give you a ballpark. So take these numbers with a grain of salt. Okay, when it comes to servicing, in terms of patches, important bulletins, Server Core. Now, here's what we did. We took all the patches from 2014. We found out what code got changed to make that patch, and then figured out whether that would have applied to Nano Server. Okay. Then, you know, so there's no gamesmanship here, right? There's true numbers. So there were 26 that applied to full server, 23 that applied to Server Core, only 9 of the important bulletins applied to Nano Server. So pretty substantial reduction. But wait for it. The critical bulletins, the ones that really matter, less than 10%, 1/10 the number. So there's 23 down to 2, only 2 critical patches. Now I'll point out, people look at this and they say, oh, well, that's good. But wait, no, it's great. Here's the thing people don't have quite focused. These are vulnerabilities that we found out about and patched. Until we patched them, they were vulnerabilities that the bad guys could have been using to exploit your systems. But if you didn't have those components, they couldn't use those vulnerabilities. So this isn't just, oh, there are fewer patches. This means dramatically more secure. Those were components that had vulnerabilities that were not available on Nano Server. So it's far more secure. And then reboots. Almost a quarter of the reboots. We go from 11 reboots down to 3. Okay, so pretty dramatic results. In terms of security improvements, here we go from drivers down a bit, from 98 down to 73. Services running, fewer than half the number of services run by default. And the port opens a little bit more than 1/3 the number of ports available. In terms of resource utilization, process count comes down a bit, 20%. The number of megabytes required to boot a system comes down a little more than half. And kernel memory, less than 1/2 the amount of kernel memory required to run Nano Server than Server Core. Okay, banally impressive numbers. deployments, setup goes from 300 seconds down to 40. 40 seconds per setup. Disk footprint goes from 4.8 gigabytes down to 400 megabytes. And VHD size goes from 6.3 gigabytes down to 410 megabytes. Almost 20 times smaller. Okay, dramatically smaller. So this is why this stuff matters. Right? These are not incremental improvements. These are phenomenal numbers. And we have not done a performance pass again. So we expect it to get better. Okay, so the point here is that talk about nano server version 1. And really going forward, it's going to be the nucleus for all of our server components, right? It is the stepping stone to dramatically refactor everything. So I mentioned we're starting off with the two cloud scenarios. But here's the model. If you have an application and you need 5 gigabytes of components, that's great. That's awesome. You should use 5 gigabytes worth of components. But you shouldn't have to have 10 gigabytes of components just because you needed those 5. So it's not just about small. Start off, it's about small. In the future, it's about componentization, where we get to what I started with, which is I want an environment where I get to use the components that I want and have just those components and nothing else. That's where we're going with NanoServer. And of course, not everything is going to run on NanoServer, fact server, RDS.
No, that's it.
That's
it.
So if you're out with that, you're out. Okay. So this is going to be available pretty shortly. Encourage you to pick it up, kick the tires, let us know what works, what doesn't, if you have problems. If you're a developer, try writing some code to this. Here's the way it actually works. We start off with the smallest nucleus of Windows that would run, and then we picked a scenario. And we said, hey, hypervisor, make that work. We then refactored the components to be able to make that scenario work, and then we do the next one, and the next one, and the next one. So that's why those numbers might get a little bit larger, because as we go and say, okay, what about the next component? We'll go and say, okay, does that need to be refactored? You know, are there additional components that need to support that scenario? Okay. So as you are doing your code, if you find scenarios that don't work, let us know. We'll evaluate whether that's a good fit for NanoServer or not, and we'll drive our refactoring based upon that. Here's a address to let us know. Okay. Now, I mentioned I had sort of two talks. That's the NanoServer talk. Now I'm going to shift to the state of PowerShell. You have any questions on NanoServer?
What was the email address?
It was
NanoServer at Microsoft?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thanks.
What was the cover there? You did say that NanoServer would run Hyper-V.
Yes.
Because I'll be honest, that was one of the rings that one of the things that drove us away from Hyper-V and staying with VMware is that I could run it off an SD card and not have to do boot from SAN or something else.
Well, and now you can scrape them off your shoe.
Well, that's...
Yeah. They're great partners.
No, I mean, that, but it's true. And that is, not, like you said, just space and, you know, all the configuration versus just being able to put on an SD card and...
No, that's right.
And run it. And that sounds exactly what we're doing here.
Kind of jumping being a little bit rude. Sure. Like that. But no, they've been great competitors. They're driving us to be the best that we can be. And in fact, yeah, sure, their great achievements in that space drove us, you know, gave us some impetus to do some of this work. But now I think you're going to find that, you know, there's no substantial difference between Windows when it comes to things like size, componentization, serviceability, etc. There's no real substantial difference between Windows and Unix and Linux now.
It's not a question on NanoServer. What's happening with the rest of the ecosystem around management platforms,
yep,
the system center family? What do you think is going to happen with the distributed network forwarding and all the other components going into this, obviously, for, you know, for storage spaces and for...
Oh, so storage spaces, SMB, all that stuff works. Not all of the storage components are there. iSCSI target's not there yet, but most of it is. You'll see the details when you get it. And basically, what the key message here is, this is the beginning of a long journey. And so, indeed, we'll have the system center components there. We're reaching out to the community. So I didn't show it here, but at Build, I showed Chef, which is a continuous deployment, you know, DevOps tool. chef running on NanoServer, so they have to do their change to get 64-bit using Ruby on NanoServer, deploying a Django framework using Nginx as a reverse forwarder, all on NanoServer.
What?
Yeah. You want to see it? Okay, I'll show you.
I should. Yeah. Is that crazy? Let me see. Chef. Oh, I don't know where it is. Huh. Okay, well, here, I'll show you how you can find out. Find it for yourself. Let's do this. Because this would be good to know.
Similarities to that in Docker, it's from an application perspective or design time, you're trying to whittle down all of your dependencies to the bare minimum, right?
So. Yes. So if you search Channel 9 and NanoServer, you'll see the NanoServer team has its own channel as of 3 o'clock this afternoon. And so there's a bunch of great videos here. I encourage you to go watch them. Hello. Where's my ding?
The screen's getting
up. I'm lost. All right. Don't want the extended cut.
So just check out Channel 9.
Here, no, I'll show it to you. It's cool. It's thinking.
Hey Adam, thanks for Chef. I appreciate it.
Yeah, you're welcome.
You've seen demos of NanoServer before, haven't you?
I have. NanoServer is fast.
Yeah, isn't it awesome?
Yeah, in fact, I would love to see Chef learning on
NanoServer. Hold on. I would
stop,
too.
Stop.
Yeah.
How can we make that happen?
Well, we can write a few recipes.
I have no idea what that's doing. Presumably, okay. Let's try that again.
You've seen demos of NanoServer before, haven't you?
I have. NanoServer is fast.
Yeah, what do you think? Is it awesome?
Yeah, in fact, I would love to see Chef learning on NanoServer.
I would too. That makes two of us.
Yeah.
How can we make that happen?
Well, we can write a few recipes, like pick a demo, maybe an open source stack like Django, Python, and we'll write the recipes and make sure we get Chef working on NanoServer.
That'd be really cool. Can we count on your support?
Totally can. We've done a lot of Microsoft integration before, so I'm looking forward to doing some more.
Excellent. Let's just go do it.
All right.
Hello, everyone. Here's an early demo of Chef Configuration Management running on NanoServer. Chef is used here to run a simple web app built with a Django web application framework and using Nginx as a reverse proxy server. Chef provides the recipes for configuring Django, Nginx, and Python, which, as you know, is what Django runs on. We start by using PowerShell remoting to remote into the NanoServer machine. We'll change directory to Chef 64 bin and run the Chef client. Let's just go ahead and fast forward this part, and we're almost ready to run our web app. Before we do, I need to copy the IP address and paste it into Internet Explorer and use port 80. This is a simple web app that helps manage polls, so I'm going to create a sample poll. After entering my credentials, I'll choose the commute poll and enter car, just because I love driving. Let's take a quick look at the Django recipe. For that, I'm going to leverage PowerShell ISE's cool new feature of editing remote files. This same Chef recipe can be used on developer system continuous integration workflows to deploy the application to various test and staging environments. That's it. In this short early demo, you saw how Chef, and therefore Ruby, Django, and Nginx all ran on NanoServer. This server may be nano in size, but certainly not in power. Thanks for watching.
You better be careful, though. People will start asking you for Ruby highlighting in ISE.
They can ask. There you go. So yeah, pretty cool stuff. All right, so now I talk to you about an hour in. I'll try to make this about half an hour and spare some time for some questions. But I'll give you a
screen still showing the screen here.
Oh, What do I need to do?
Go back to.
Oh, you know what? I think it's the. There you go. Bet you that'll work.
Okay. So I'm going to kind of zoom through the state of the PowerShell. And it's a fact that I had a conversation with the CEO of Chef when I first met him. He said we were talking about desired state configuration and their support for desired state configuration. And he said that they have long been watching PowerShell. And he said it's really the story of sustained investment. He said, often we see Microsoft get into something, and then they get into it, and they talk a lot about it, and then they don't talk about it. Says, but that's not been the case with PowerShell. PowerShell, you invested in it, it came out, and then you did more, and then you did more, and then you did more. And that was why he felt comfortable betting his company on the desired state configuration platform, because it was new. He knew it was something that Microsoft was committed to. So I thought that was a great story, and in fact, correct. So I thought I'd kind of walk through this and say that, you know, really we started off, when I started off, I wrote the Monad Manifesto around the time frame of Windows Server 2000. It's actually 2002 that I first published it internally, but we had started PowerShell around 2001. At that point, we had Vision and Prototype. PowerShell version 1 shipped around Windows Server 2008, so that was quite a long time, but it was quite a substantial version 1. So whereas sort of the defining feature was .NET commandlets, we have full interactive shell, we had a really substantial scripting language, we had the object pipeline and utilities, we had namespaces, we had a debugger for an interactive shell, sort of unheard of. We had great security, we had the adaptive type system, we had help. This was not your traditional version 1. This was really quite a substantial version 1. And in fact, a lot of people at the time said, oh, great, you know, what are you going to do next? So what do you mean, what are you going to do next? What's your next big thing? So what are you talking about? Well, now that PowerShell is done, I said, my friend, you're out of your mind. We're not done. There's a lot to do here. So the PowerShell version 2, of course, the key thing, the thing everyone wanted was remoting. Okay, but in fact, there was a lot more to it. We brought up script commandlets. This is a core piece of technology that allows metaprogramming. Just say programs that generate programs. And underneath the covers, that's a technique that we use that has really transformed PowerShell. It's one of the reasons why you have such great coverage today is because of this metaprogramming enabled by being able to write commandlets in script. We get the comment-based help. We have modules. PowerShell transaction support came here. We had the data language splotting. We started now at this point, to be clear, we always wanted to support both operators and developers. I mean, we were DevOps before DevOps was cool. When you read the Monad Manifesto, you'll see that. We want to have a single tool that could be used by both the developers and the operators so that they could help one another. It's the reason why we have squiggle brackets instead of some of the other traditional scripting language constructs. So that it looks more like a programming language, but it has an interactive experience that admins like. Now, in reality, whereas we tried to bridge both those gaps, in the beginning, we were very heavily oriented towards the operators. And then you see here now in version 2, we start to focus in on adding things like try catches to try and make it easier and more friendly to developers as well. Basically, we added ISC, had eventing, backend jobs, script internationalization. In PowerShell version 3, boy, this was the crossing the chasm release. You know, at this point, I like to say, most people, when they use PowerShell, they want a world where they think about what they want, they type it, and they get it. And prior to PowerShell version 3, I think, what do we have? I don't know, there was a relatively small set of commandlets. And if you that's what you wanted to do, it was great. But if it wasn't, then you had to go and program COM or try and find something in WMI. In PowerShell version 3, we had this CDXML, which allowed the Windows team to now write commandlets in WMI, native code. And the CDXML then used that metaprogramming technique to generate all the commandlets. So that's why you have such great coverage in this release. So anyway, just a ton of stuff, an explosion of features. It was really quite a substantial release. And again, people say, okay, well, what are you going to do now that it's done? It's like, what are you talking about? It's not done. So in PowerShell version 4, we started focusing in on desired state configuration. As I would say, configuration was core technology that was required for, to do cloud management. Cloud was clearly where we were going. But still, we did a lot more in that release. And now in PowerShell version 5, the one that's coming up shortly, the focus is in on DevOps. Sorry for the formatting here. Switch templates, that was a bad idea. Anyway, so huge focus in on desired state configuration, using that quite a bit. We have Package Manager, that's the one yet thing we had. We have the Azure Extension Agent. We have Script Analyzer. We're introducing classes. So for, again, for developers, classes, using Segment, lots of work around security. So just a, another massive release, and we are not done yet. So again, the story of PowerShell is the story of sustained investment. And the question is, well, will it continue? And the answer is this. The cloud really has people's hair on fire, and PowerShell really is a bucket of water for them. Cloud's about automation, the ability to get a process and then apply it to lots of machines over and over and over again. So automation is crucial. There will be continued investment in PowerShell because of the cloud. However, I really believe that Microsoft's contribution to PowerShell are going to be dwarfed by the community contributions. Until recently, the vast majority of all the important pieces of PowerShell code was provided by the PowerShell team. Now, that was not always the case. Clearly, our ISV community did some great work. VMware did a great piece of work. But the vast majority of the important pieces of code used by everybody was provided by the PowerShell team. If that's not false now, it will certainly be false, you know, shortly. The community is really producing very high quality work at a very large rate. So, you know, there's just this community explosion in the community. We've always had great support, as I mentioned, ISVs had great support. We achieved critical mass in 2012, and what we're finding is that now a bunch of our user base is on older versions of the operating system. As they move off the older versions of the operating system, where using PowerShell really was tough, and you had to go do a lot of stuff, and as they move and adopt the newer versions of the operating system, where it's far easier to adopt PowerShell because of the increased coverage and later versions, we're seeing more and more people using PowerShell. So the number of people in the community are rising. And in this year in PowerShell, we just do a ton of stuff for the community. So we have this package manager and PowerShell get. This dramatically reduces the friction for individuals to be able to take a component and share it with others, and then you to find those components and install them yourself on your machines. We have Script Analyzer and Pester, okay? These support PowerShell being used in production environments, okay? So you want to be able to say, oh, I wrote the script, but you know, I modified it, but it break things. You want to have unit tests. You want to be able to have standard practices and make sure that the scripts being used in the production environment adhere to those. Now, Pester, I guess I didn't talk about this. That's a problem with editing. So Pester is a community-written open source unit test framework. And what we announced 2 weeks ago, at the PowerShell Summit, was that Microsoft is going to ship Pester in Windows. That's right. We are taking open source software, first time ever, we're taking open source software and shipping it in Windows. It was crazy. We're in a room like this, and they said, see that guy over there? That's Dave. Dave wrote Pester. We're shipping Dave's code in Windows. Y'all, Dave, a beer. I mean, it's just crazy. So, very exciting stuff. Okay. Next, we have the desired state configuration platform and desired state configuration resource kit. This extends the community to DevOps. We've got classes and posh tools, so it extends it to more developer focus. And we're now taking a number of our our assets and moving them to Linux. So the desired state configuration agent. And OMI is an open source implementation of WMI. These are now available on Linux. So we're growing the community in all directions. Okay, by the way, so I said 2015 versus PowerShell be next, and the reason is that some of these components are going to go down level. So this PowerShell Package Manager and PSGet, we think that's so important that that's going to go, we're going to make that available to previous versions of PowerShell. So definitely PowerShell 3, probably not PowerShell 2, but these components will be available to that. Hester, in fact, works on PowerShell version 2 and above. So, all that said, we're going to get great community support. The Microsoft support continues, but you're going to see it changes in kind of quality. And by that, by quality, what I really mean is, so it's going to continue and it's going to increase. So first off, here's what we're doing in PowerShell version 5. Ton of stuff, great stuff. So a lot around security, talk about that. Lots of new utility stuff, lots of new modules. PS Readline, another open source piece of software we're bringing in. Yeah.
So what about PDT? What's going on with this?
Okay, so PDT is a parallel deployment, PowerShell deployment toolkit. That was a component that was written in workflow and did the parallel deployments. We are in fact redoing PDT using desired state configuration, and I don't want to finish that sentence. So, and it's being renamed XDeploy. Yeah, and watch that space. We're investing significantly in that area.
Because yeah, it seemed like it was floundering for a little bit, and in terms of like how it's structurally going to move forward.
So that was originally written by one of the guys in the CAT team. We moved that guy from the CAT team to the engineering team. That guy's now an engineer.
Right.
So, and I can't tell you the rest of that story, but you can connect with us. Including we're increasing the number of network switch manager commandlets, TMP device, etc. And something here that's really crazy, PowerShell remoting over VM bus. So you can PowerShell remoting to a guest agent, to a guest that doesn't even have a network card in it.
So crazy.
Yeah.
So the coolest function of Windows Azure PAC is the remoting to console capability. No one really gets to see that, but that was really cool. I'm assuming that's the iteration.
I'm not sure which one you're referring to.
It gives you
VM Connect.
Yeah.
VM Connect. The catch is that it's not available in Azure.
Azure.
Right. But it's in the Azure PAC.
It's in the Azure PAC.
No, this is a little different. Okay. This allows you to. Similar. Anyway, so there's a ton of great stuff here. I don't want to get too focused in on this. Take it in. We'll be talking a lot about this. And here's really what I want to talk about, is this distinction between platform and problem solving. And really, we're shifting in percentages. By and large, PowerShell's been delivered with a platform mindset and a little bit of problem solving. And we're shifting to be predominantly problem solving and a little bit of platform. Now, a platform basically says, I'm enabling other people to solve a problem. Right? So I'm not going to try and take a point of view. I'm going to let 1,000 blossoms bloom. I'm going to be trying to be as general as possible. Problem solving takes responsibility for solving the problem. It has a point of view. It doesn't let 1,000 blossoms bloom, etc. And you'll see that we're making a shift towards more problem solving. Now let me get really concrete. By the way, this shift is firmly grounded in the change in leadership at the company under Satya. Right? Satya is absolutely passionate that we listen to our customers. I mean, that is the thing. Listen to your customers. Go where your customers are. Do what the customers say to do. You know, don't get stuck in your head. Go solve their problems. Make sure they use our software. Make sure they're successful with our software. Make sure they love our software. So here, I'm just producing a platform. Someone else will solve our customers' problems. Like, no, solve the customers' problems. Okay? So that said, we're still a platform. So it's really just a change in percentages, not a switch.
Are they going to listen to SMEs still?
Never? That sounds like a loaded question. We're going to listen to our customers.
And, yeah, which customers?
That's a great question. That is a great question. We are going to primarily focus in on the cloud. Okay, so let me give you a couple examples. In the fabric, in the cloud platform solution, this is this cloud in a box configuration of 1 to 4 racks. This thing is entirely configured using PowerShell. Okay, it did not use PowerShell deployment toolkit. It did not use desired state configuration. We had two problems. One was we had a developer team do this. The developers did not like PowerShell. They didn't like it. In fact, we had some guys say, I want to get off this project. It's like, really? Why? This is a crazy important project. Why don't you get off? I said, I hate PowerShell. Okay, well, let's talk about that. What do you hate? And also, desired state configuration was too early. Okay. So we we found out was that the developers, PowerShell has shell semantics, and they didn't like that, right? They wanted more programming semantics. Now let me be clear about this. Let me give you a clear example, because I'm sure if you use PowerShell, you've encountered this, and this is what just explodes their head. So if you write a function foo, and you do something to emit a, and let's just say you say get service a star and get process star ss, right? These three things are going to get emitted to the pipeline, right? So if you say $x equals foo, x is going to have a, these services, and these processes, right? That's the way a shell works, okay? Now, we made a mistake, right? This is an error. In our desire to be more friendly to developers, we said, okay, well, these are shell semantics, but developers like developer semantics, right? They like developer things, right? Developers like return statements. So what we said was, hey, a developer can use a return statement, okay? So then he uses a return statement, and he does this, right? And so what's $x? A developer thinks it's going to be x, but it's not. It's a, this, and that. They just blew their head up. So that was a mistake, right? They just don't like that. We should have said that if you use a return statement, all these things go to the bit bucket. They get thrown away, and the only thing that gets returned is return. Anyway, so that was an example that they really, that those guys, well, it was just one guy. He really hated that. Anyway, so fine. Now what we did was we provided classes with programming semantics. In programming, if you do this, guess what? The only thing that's returned is X. You have to have a well-defined return statement. It is very friendly to developers. Okay, so if you like developer semantics, we now have the ability to use them. Additionally, it wasn't in Visual Studio. ISE? Oh, like ISE. They don't like ISE. They're Visual Studio people. As good as ISE was, they don't care. It's not Visual Studio. So now we have Visual Studio integration. Apparently that's hidden. This says, this is a URL to a tool called Posh Tools. Posh Tools is a wonderful thing. You see, if you look it up in the PowerShell Summit from last week, there's a great half-hour session on this. I think maybe 45-minute session.
That's Adam Driscoll?
No. Well, Adam Driscoll started it, yep. But it's basically Visual Studio. You use Visual Studio and you edit PowerShell and you have debugging and you hit a breakpoint and you get watch windows and local. Wonderful. Really great stuff. There were no unit tests or validation frameworks. These are professional developers. These are the things that they expect. So now we've got Tester. We have we're building an operational validation framework in Tester. There were no code testing tools. So we're doing script analytics. Desired state configuration was not up to the task. So we're doing desired state configuration plus. That was the major investment for this round of operating system. And the parallel deployment tool, PowerShell deployment toolkit is now becoming X-deploy. And by the way, so what that really means is that the next generation of this is being built using X-deploy, which is to say desired state configuration.
Are you guys committing code back to the Tester GitHub
repo? Yep. Yes, we are. Yes, we are. Oh, and then again, they found it hard to find community assets. There was some great stuff out there, but they couldn't find it. So now we make it easy to get that. So this is an example of saying, well, look, hey, you know what? Somebody else can do these things. We're the platform. Somebody else can go do Tester. Somebody else can do a script analyzer. And that was true. In fact, I don't know if you know this. Link online, completely run using PowerShell. Okay, completely run using PowerShell. They said, hey, wait a second. I don't want my operators just writing arbitrary scripts and running them on my production environment. We need to have rules about these scripts. So they went and wrote their own script analyzer. They wrote their own parser, and they have their set of rules that says everything must adhere to these guidelines. So they wrote that, right? But that's, and in the platform, we enabled them to do that. But here we're saying, no, now we're going to solve that problem. So we solve that problem. We write the script analyzer. Next is security. Here's the problem. The bad guys love PowerShell. I don't know if you're aware of this, but the bad guys love PowerShell. There's now malware written in PowerShell. Okay? Now, why is that? And there's two answers. The first is that the bad guys have exquisite taste in tools. they know greatness when they see it. And the second is that, well, no, actually, sort of being serious, they love PowerShell's great, right? It's this fantastic tool, allows you to do so much with so little. But like a chainsaw, right? Chainsaw applied to tree, good. Chainsaw applied to leg, not so good, right? So PowerShell is this fantastic tool, but the bad guys can use it for evil as well, okay? So we're seeing much more of this, increased number of PowerShell malware. One of the things they love about it is the fact that you can load software and run it in memory without ever touching the disk, which means that it can't be audited. And so it gives them operational security that they like. And there are solutions like anti-malware, intrusion detection, et cetera, but they don't have sufficient coverage, which is to say they don't have the proper hooks to be able to detect the bad guys using PowerShell to do malware. So again, this is a major investment. So step number one, PowerShell malware. Now with Windows 10, we've integrated PowerShell with the anti-malware frameworks. So Defender and all the third-party anti-malware tools will be able to perform malware detection on PowerShell. In fact, here we solved this as a, we solved the problem, but we did it in a platform way. We're still platform guys. We changed the platform so it works with both PowerShell and any scripting language. Okay, so now any scripting language in Windows 10 can be, their content can be analyzed by the anti-malware, any anti-malware agent. Dynamic code doesn't get logged. We have a group policy for what's called deep script block logging, where every script block can be logged, so we know exactly what happens in the environment. Next, when you connect with PowerShell, you can connect as one person, but then run it as another. That's a particular configuration. When you ran it as another person, all the logging showed up as that other person. Now it shows up as that other person, but it also says who it's running on behalf of. So everything, you know exactly who's doing what. The next is it's difficult to thread together what happens when somebody, so you detect something bad happened, right? You did all this event collection, you moved it, did some big data analytics, you saw it, wait, something's wrong here. The problem is, imagine you had 10 people all working on that system. All these individual events go to the event log, and now it's somewhere in the system. How do you stitch together what somebody did? It's very, very, very difficult to do that next step of. There's detection. Event logs are great for detection. Then there's forensics. What were they actually doing? It's hard to do that. So now we have something called transcripts. We've had transcripts for a while. They only worked on the console. Now they work everywhere. And there's a notion of a system transcript that says, system-wide, everything that gets done using PowerShell gets logged. This is an over-the-shoulder view of what's going on. What did the user type? What did they get? Okay, and we have a group policy for being able to set that. Now, if there is a bad guy in the system, remember I said we were doing this assume breach, so assume there's a bad guy in the system, they can actually go into those logs and find sensitive information to be used to go attack other parts of the system. So what we have now is called protected event logging, where you can encrypt the contents of the logs. Okay. Now, it turns out everything can have sensitive data. So as we did this work to do the protected event logging, again, we did it as a general purpose mechanism, used exactly the same techniques, our code, surfaced it as a set of commandlets, so that you can cryptographically encrypt and decrypt anything on Windows. And then lastly, as it turned out that I mentioned to you that there's this technique people could use to subvert whitelisting, be able to run code in memory. Now PowerShell will detect if your system is in whitelisting mode and automatically convert to a profile, a language profile, where this is not possible. So automatically secure. So these are two examples, there are many more, but these are two examples of the shift from kind of platform thinking, hey, we're just gonna do this platform and good things will happen, to, hey, we're gonna go solve these problems. And you'll see more and more of that.
So will you, so I know Azure probably has some of these problems too, but key management?
Yeah.
Like, what's gonna happen there? I mean, we're getting to the point now for the number of systems we're dealing with, how you deal with these environments, and obviously there's a lot of exploits that are out there, you know, especially with Amazon, people posting their key sets and GitHub repos, and they have whole agents that are sitting there scrubbing and just searching for those, and then going and spinning up cycles under their accounts, and you get the bill for it, but you don't actually, and they get the workload time, right?
They do.
So there's things like that. What is there anything that's going to be built in? How's that framework going to come together for like Visual Studio, PowerShell, and other environments to deploy workloads, whether it's on or off?
Yeah. So that build, we're going to talk about some of that, but I think the elements that you're looking for remain problems. But you will see some new technology that basically allows greater protections, quite a higher degree of protection. Let me just be clear about the scenario. Scenario is, I'm your hoster, I've got your VM, and the government comes to me and says, give me all the data, right? And of course, we've got a team of lawyers that say, get out of here, take us to court, and say, we're gonna hold you in contempt. Oh, you know that, the US government has said, hey, Microsoft, we're gonna hold you in contempt if you don't give us this data. And we've said, fine, hold us in contempt. We don't think that's legitimate. So we have a team of lawyers that will protect you. But if a hoster, a third-party hoster, is using our technology, they might not have that team of lawyers. So you're gonna see it build a mechanism, a technology, that basically says that hoster does not have the ability to see the contents of your VM, that only you have the ability to see that. That you can say, these VMs can only run on these trusted hosts, and they run in a way that nobody can see the contents except for you. So if the government or some bad guys or evil people wanna see your stuff, they gotta go talk to you, not that hoster. Maybe I gave too much details, you'll see that. But you specifically talked about key management. Key management does not get significantly better in this time frame. It's still a challenge. So my predictions from my 2014 State of the Union PowerShell talk was that we were gonna have very fast cycles, faster cycles. We've been releasing the Windows Management Framework for PowerShell every couple months. The Desired State Configuration Resource Kit has been released almost every month. When we delivered PowerShell Desired State Configuration, the joke was, you know, we're on this agile footing. The agile guys have this model of minimal viable product, right? Don't spend all this time thinking of stuff in your head. Get to the minimal viable product, give it to your users, use their feedback to iterate. So the joke was that with Desired State Configuration, the first version, we really shipped sort of a version 0.9. We weren't even quite 1.0. But we moved very quickly. We released a resource kit. The first version of Desired State Configuration had 12 resources in it. We did the resource kit. Then the next month, we did more. I think we're over 180 resources now. And these are not trivial resources. We have resources like SharePoint. There's like a dozen things for SharePoint. SQL, Exchange, et cetera. So very rich set of resources. And we then iterated and did Desired State Configuration. Really brings us up to an update. Really brings us up to also like 1.5 version. Very substantial update. I said that we were going to have even better community engagement. We're going to focus in on developers and DevOps scenarios. Our base assumption here is that with business value comes from an increased consumption of computing. And that's the core Microsoft belief, always has been. We believe things get better the more you compute. Why is that? Because computing is synthetic thought, and the more thought you have, the better the results are. Recently, last few years, we've really started to get good at translating computing into business impact, you know, revenue, big data, et cetera. Now, the problem has been that there's always been friction in consuming lots of computing. In the past, that friction was all about money. Computers were expensive. But today, computers aren't expensive. And virtual machines are very inexpensive, and cloud machines are downright cheap, okay? But there's additional friction now in terms of management. So we believe if we can eliminate the friction to be able to consume lots of computing, you can grow your business, you can do better things. So that's our mission. Our mission is to make it easy to consume lots of computing because we think you're gonna benefit from doing that. And my prediction last year was that we would open source PowerShell. So that was last year's set of predictions. Last week, I made a new set of predictions. I predicted we have faster cycle times, we get better in community engagement, we would develop on developers and DevOps, same base assumptions, same mission, and the same prediction. So basically, things haven't changed that much. The big difference is that we're going to focus in on problem solving. By the way, that's not that nothing has changed. That is, these are what we're going to be doing. This is what we've been doing. It's the right set of things. We're going to continue doing that. The open source PowerShell there was based upon I just looked at the physics of the situation. You know, I'm a distinguished engineer. I'm the lead architect for Windows Server and System Center. And part of my job is to just look at things and see the physics and make predictions and for those predictions to be right. Not, oh, I've got a plan, and therefore I'm going to predict what's going to happen because I have a plan. But rather, I just looked at the dynamics and I said, yeah, this is what's going to make sense. And it continues to make sense. Now, obviously, you can't just open source things. Turns out that to open source something successfully, you have to be able to build it. The Windows build process is a special, unique thing. We can barely reproduce that. You certainly would not be able to reproduce that. So in order to open source a Windows component, you have to be able to, the community has to be able to build it. Next is the community has to be able to contribute in a way that doesn't break things, which is to say you need to be able to take your tests and make them available so that when a community member makes a change, they can run your tests and find out did they break things or not. Because they don't want to break things and you don't want them to break things. So again, Windows has a unique test harness and it's very tightly cemented into the way we do business. So open sourcing any component of Windows is a big challenge. It's not just about desire, but there's lots of core mechanics. Nevertheless, I still predict that the physics here are undeniable. This will almost certainly happen at some point. So PowerShell going forward, I'm just crazy optimistic about the community. The PowerShell Summit, so if you haven't been, I strongly encourage you to check out the PowerShell videos. But honestly, it's not the same thing. You really want to get to the PowerShell Summit. Next year, it's going to be held in Bellevue. And the great thing about Bellevue is that last year we had it in Bellevue, like the whole team showed up. It's like, oh, we're going to do introductions. It was like a 15-minute affair. It's like, hi, I'm Joe. Here's what I do. Here's what I work on. It's like, oh, I got to talk to that guy. And then the next person. We meet everybody. And the PowerShell team has wonderful people. The real value of the summit is not so much the presentations. You can watch those online. They're great. Watch them. The real value is when the cameras go off and people go for snacks. And it's like, hey, what about this? What about that? Fantastic. It's like the world's best PowerShell people are at the summit and get to meet them. Anyway, so I'm very optimistic about the summit. We will continue to increase our investments in PowerShell for two reasons. One is we're perfectly aligned with Satya's vision, and we really are in line with the requirements of the cloud. Oh, there you go. That's it.
So I'm a little bit over, but
just real quick with the ASP.NET AppV Next stuff and being able to run cross-compatible on Linux, Mac. You know, people are going to start asking you, when am I going to get a PowerShell prompt on a Linux node? Mm. You know, understanding that it's just going to be the core COR, mm-hmm. the PowerShell core, that seems more feasible. Now, you know, a couple of years ago when we were talking about it, there was the one open source project already out there, but no one was really, it wasn't pertinent. But now it seems more
So Eric brings a great point. There is a distinction between open sourcing and being available on Linux. Those are two very different things. And he's just pointing out that, hey, you know, when will PowerShell be available on Linux? Because one of the core components, the CLR, of course, the CLR wasn't available on Linux. It was mono, but that was different. And then there was the core CLR. Now that's being made available, but then PowerShell wasn't on that. But you just said PowerShell is now being coded to core CLR. And all I can say is I have nothing to announce today.
But you're not saying no.
I say look at the physics. The physics are pretty clear. Look, we'll take an ASP so and that we're bringing on Linux, right? The company, this is not your dad's Microsoft. This is not your dad's Microsoft. Again, it's like gymnastics, right? I cannot overstate the change that has come about because of our new leader, Satya. Satya's just fantastic. He's a breath of fresh air. And it's just like gymnastics, right? In gymnastics, if you want the body to go somewhere, you move the head there, right? The head, the body follows the head. We have a new head, Satya. He is absolutely passionate around making sure our customers are successful, right? One of my favorite things is that great picture of Satya with the background that says Microsoft loves Linux. Look, I'm the head of, I'm the distinguished engineer and the lead engineer of Windows Server, and that's like my favorite moment of the year. And why is that? Because he's making a very clear statement that everything's up for grabs except the success of our customers. We're going to do whatever it takes to be successful with our customers. Now, look, let me just be clear. This is not some, this is just good business, right? Now, here's the thing you got to get in focus to help understand. In the context of Azure, we make more money if someone uses 10 instances of Linux than they have 2 instances of Windows. Okay, because it's a consumption model, it's a volume model. So that's why my mission is to make it easy to consume as much computing as possible, whether that's Windows or Linux. So when I get up and I tell you next week about all the incredible improvements that we've made in our Linux support, you should not think, oh, those are nice guys. You should think, oh, those guys really understand their business and that it's important that they be beyond reproach, that they have to be better than the best, because people aren't going to naturally believe that they do great Linux support, and they're investing accordingly, because it makes great business. Now, the other thing I'll point out is if you take a look at Azure, what do you see? You see a bunch of fantastic services available how? As DLLs? No. They're available as REST APIs. You call those REST APIs, you get charged for calling those REST APIs. Call the service bus, call it 1,000 times, you get charged X. Don't call it, don't get charged. The more you use it, the more you get charged, right? It's a great model of the cloud. Now, what does it take to call a REST API? Anything you want. We're going to make the same amount of money whether you call it from a Windows box or from a Linux box. It's the consumption of the APIs. So the point I want to make here, and to be clear, I'm still the distinguished engineer, lead architect for Windows Server, and I'm going to move that forward, and I'm going to compete. But the reality is I'm also going to make sure that Linux is a full first-class citizen. And if you want to be use that, that you are successful on my platform and that it's the best experience possible. Now, in that context, you have to ask yourself the question, what things would someone do to make it easy to consume as much computing as possible? And you can assume we're doing those things. That's my answer. Does that make sense? I like to kind of like stop and like get down to the business logic so that it's really clear. My favorite joke is that one of the two guys in the forest and the bear's going to get them and they're going to run. And the one guy stops and he takes off his pack and he puts on a pair of running shoes. And his buddy says, Tom, I don't know what you think you're doing, but a grizzly bear can run 35 miles an hour. There's no way you can outrun a grizzly bear, even with tennis shoes. And he says, well, Fred, I don't have to outrun the bear. I just have to outrun you. And the point of that is sometimes you see people and the things that they do seem crazy unless you understand their motivation. That's why I am a fan of explaining the motivation and the thinking so that you understand the context for the decisions and you can make predictions. Those are far more accurate predictors of what we will do than to say, I have a set of plans. Because if you understand the agile world, you realize that the only valid plans are the plans for the next month. A month after that, who knows? It can all change based upon customer feedback. So when someone tells you their plans, in general, you got to take them with a grain of salt. If you understand their motivations and their mindset, you'll be able to make predictions and they will be accurate. Not necessarily the time frames, but the direction. So that's why I'd like to explain that. Anyway, I hope this was useful. We have some stickers over here. We got the amazing PowerShell Boy sticker, PowerShell Man sticker, Superman, and we got some Nano Server stickers. I hope this was useful.
Thanks.